Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Burke's Cardiologists.
Good evening and welcome to Heart to Heart. I'm Dave Spector. Again with me, Dr. Andy Waxler. And tonight we're going to talk about the new blood pressure numbers. We were just in the newspaper about 2 weeks ago, and also a stent study that was just released, so we can keep you up to date on the latest things happening. Andy, what's with these new blood pressure numbers? It looks like they're lower because people I've talked to said, my blood pressure was okay 6 months ago, and now they're telling me it's too high.
So one of the things I love about cardiology and about medicine in general is that it's a moving target, right? I'm 51 years old, and if you're a decent doctor, you're really a lifelong student, because we're constantly learning things. We're constantly doing studies. We're constantly embracing new technology. So things change. So What about blood pressure? What's the deal with blood pressure? As Dave correctly said, just about maybe 6 weeks ago or so, the new blood pressure guidelines were released. So what's up with blood pressure? Dave, do you know what we call high blood pressure? Do you know what?
Hypertension.
Well, yeah, but hypertension. What's like a nickname for hypertension? I'll give you a hint. It's called the silent killer. And I like to tell patients, why do we call it the silent killer? Well, there's two reasons. A, it's silent, doesn't have any symptoms, and B, it'll kill you. So I'm not trying to be a wise guy, I'm not trying to be funny, but whoever called it the silent killer is actually a smart person. High blood pressure has no symptoms until it's really, really, really high, and then it can cause headaches and things like that. But for the most part, high blood pressure has no symptoms. But over time, it starts to damage four organs in your body. Dave, can you name any of those?
Heart,
got one.
Lungs?
No. I won't quiz Dave anymore because he'll get mad at me. But heart, now I'm a heart doctor, so of course it has to be number one. And that's good, Dave. Dave got the most important one. But it also will affect your brain, your eyes, and your kidneys. So heart, brain, eyes, kidneys will be damaged over time from high blood pressure, slow wear and tear over years. So, high blood pressure is one of the top two causes of patients when they get a little bit older to need dialysis. It's the number one cause of older people to have strokes. It causes eye problems, and it does cause thickening of the heart muscle, and it's the number one cause of what we call congestive heart failure. So high blood pressure over years does do damage, and it starts to affect patients. So, that's been a problem for a long time. 100 years ago, doctors, they didn't have much to do, but they knew about high blood pressure. And the funny thing is, early in the 1900s, right, I'm 51, so I was born in 66, but in the 40s and 50s and before, in the 1900s, they literally thought that normal blood pressure was 100 plus age. So if you're 80 years old and normal blood pressure was 180, I mean, literally, that's what people thought. By the time the 60s and 70s came around, I went to medical school in the 80s, that was already out the window. We knew that that's not true. But there is something to be said for, as people get older, the blood pressure does go up. So whoever came up with this rule, 100 plus age, did take into account that, older people like my friend Dave here do have higher blood pressure. Sorry, Dave.
And I'll write down what my blood pressure was the last time I was there and show it to you.
Normal.
Below normal.
Below normal. Dave's a cool customer. The point is, though, as we get older, our blood pressure does go up naturally. So that's absolutely correct. But 180 is not a good blood pressure for an 80-year-old. So for the last 15 or 20 years, the magic number has been 140 over 90. Now, there's two numbers. There's what we call the systolic, that's the top number, and the diastolic, that's the bottom number. Dave, we've known since 1989. In 1989, a study called the SHEP, S-H-E-P study came out, and that stands for systolic hypertension in the elderly population. 1989, we knew that people over the age of about 55 or 60 their most important number is the top number. So for if you're over about 50 or 55, it's the top number that's important. We want to get that below 140.
Yeah, we got a home viewer. Home viewer, good evening, and what can we do for you tonight?
Good evening. How are you? I have a question, and it's a two-parter. Number one, does your cholesterol level have something to do with your blood pressure?
No, they are completely separate. One does not affect the other, but with one caveat, and that is they do work together to cause hardening of the arteries. So having one does not mean you're going to have the other, mm-hmm. but if you have both, it's a double whammy affecting the walls of the arteries.
And the second question, before you have blood work that would measure your cholesterol level, does what you intake 24 to 48 hours before that blood test, such as if you were to eat high-fat foods within 48 hours of that blood test, could that skew your blood results and give you an elevated cholesterol and triglyceride level?
It could. It could, to some degree, especially the triglycerides. So of the three parts of the cholesterol, the LDL bad cholesterol and the HDL good cholesterol and the triglycerides, the one that's the most dependent on what you do, both good and bad, right? If you go and eat ice cream all day for a week, or if you do the opposite, if you all of a sudden decide I'm going to be a good boy and eat a really good diet, you have the most control over the triglycerides.
So could you just quickly explain the triglycerides, what they are?
So the triglycerides are the part of the cholesterol that is most related to carbs. So people that eat a lot of cookies, cakes, breads, rolls, I like to say if it's white, do not bite. And I have that problem. We all eat too much simple, bad carbs. That makes the triglyceride level in your bloodstream go up. It's really the fattiest part of the cholesterol. And when I was a medical student, we didn't think the triglycerides were that important. We've always known that LDL is the most important part of the cholesterol to cause blockage. But what we've learned over the last 20 years is the triglycerides are important also. So, but where you really get into trouble is people that don't fast for 12 to 14 hours. We always tell people fast at least 12, but ideally 14 hours, and then their triglycerides can be higher than, they can be sort of artificially elevated on the blood test.
And I guess that's a particular problem for diabetics.
That's correct. You hit the nail on the head. Yeah. Diabetics tend to run high triglycerides. People that kind of carry weight around their middle. I tend to carry weight around my middle. You know, people that have like a little bit of a, I don't drink much beer, but a little bit of a so-called beer belly or a, you know, spare tire over your belt. People that have a little bit of a tummy and people that are diabetics, those are the people that tend to run high triglycerides and have a low HDL good cholesterol. So diabetes, big tummy, high triglycerides, low HDL, those things go together. And there's actually a name for that. It's called metabolic syndrome. The best way to defeat metabolic syndrome is stop eating carbs, go for a walk, lose weight. People say it can't be that simple. The answer is it kind of is. It's just hard to do those.
Not that it's that simple to lose weight and start exercising a little bit, but...
The concept is simple, but it's hard. It's really hard. You know, there was a study in Connecticut. I want everybody out there to Google this, all right? I didn't believe it. Google this. There was a study 4 or 5 years ago at Connecticut College, which ironically is where my mom went to college 60 years ago. Connecticut College, they did a study, and I'm going to get it a little bit wrong, but Google it. Read it yourself. They gave some rats cocaine. Then they gave some rats, I think it was, I don't want to say a product name, but...
Oreos.
That may be the correct product. It's possible that you're right. And they demonstrated that the rats were addicted on the same degree to cocaine and something that we all eat on a daily basis. And I didn't believe it. I said, I have never tried cocaine in my life. I'm comfortable saying that. I could take a lie detector test. But I understand it's pretty good. It's incredible to me that a rat that doesn't know any better has equal addiction potential. Now, granted, this is one study, so take it with a grain of salt. You know, you take one study with a grain of salt, but this blew my mind. So the take-home message is we are all addicted to these snack foods. They're good. And so we don't even think of it. You know, everybody knows somebody who's had a cocaine problem or heroin problem. I mean, you've heard of the opioid crisis. There's this opioid crisis across our country, including in our backyard in Berks County. It's terrible. It's terrible. Nobody thinks of snack foods as the same thing, but you know, you read this study and it kind of makes you start to wonder. You know, you start thinking, we're all addicted to these things. And so that's why we all have, not all, but a lot of us have this metabolic syndrome. High triglycerides, low HDL, high sugar, heavy in the middle. And the best way to do it is cut your carbs, go for a walk, lose weight. I've told you everything. I mean, I've given you all my secrets in a 5-minute phone call.
Well, thank you. You must be listening to your wife because you look pretty good.
Wait, are you friends with my wife? Did she tell you to?
Yeah, she told me to say that. No, I'm only fooling. All right, good night, fellas. Thank you so much.
Thank you for calling.
Right, bye-bye.
On this triglycerides thing, they tell you to fast for 12 hours before you take. If you ate bad, as we're describing badly, in that 24 to 12 hour period before, is that going to affect?
I think it can affect
all of them,
or
just the triglycerides?
I think it's mostly the triglycerides. I think the answer is it mostly affects the triglycerides. But Dave, let me get back to the high blood pressure because I don't want to lose that concept.
Okay.
And that is, we talked earlier about the new guidelines. So until about 6 weeks ago, the magic number had been 140 over 90. And that's the definition of high blood pressure. And again, for those people over about 60 years old, the top number is the more important number. The guidelines recently came out and said they're now recommending that 130, and I think, don't quote me, I think the bottom number, I can't remember if it's 80 or 85, might be 80, but the top number has been moved down to 130. And the reason why is we've known for about 15 or 20 years that even above 120, the top number, the systolic number, the risk of stroke starts to go up. So believe it or not, between 120 and 130, the person that has systolic blood pressure 130 has a higher risk of stroke as they get older. Stroke is a big problem in older patients, and stroke, there are many kinds of strokes, and there's many causes of strokes. So I want to be clear. There's different kinds of strokes, there's different things that cause strokes. But the number one cause of stroke in older people is high blood pressure. So there's a direct relationship between older people, high blood pressure, stroke. Those things are lined up. And so the idea here is we want to get the blood pressure down to lower the risk of stroke. And that's the idea. People say, oh, it's some conspiracy. Why are they changing the numbers? There's no conspiracy. We're trying to lower the risk of stroke. And that's all it is. Now, people say, well, what if you overtreat my blood pressure? If we make your blood pressure too low, that's not good either. There's actually a thing called the J curve. The J
curve. What is too low on blood pressure?
Well, the J curve basically says as you get the blood pressure lower, people do better until you get it too low and then they start to do worse. That's the it looks like a capital J. So there's a point where lower is better, but then you go too low and it's not better. And everybody's different. The answer is everybody's different. I don't know the magic number. I think it's about 90 or 95, the top number. So the concepts here are that everybody's different, and it's probably 95 or 100. I like to tell my patients, if you feel good and you're triple digits, you're good. I mean, I have patients every day that their blood pressure is 107 over 80. I say, do you get dizzy? They said, no. I said, you're tired? They said, no. They say, I feel great. I go, good. I'll see you in 6 months. So the answer is, as long as the top number is 95 or 100 and the person's not getting dizzy, they're probably fine. We don't know the exact number and everybody's different. But a big mistake that people make, though, let's say a patient hasn't been a good patient and hasn't really gone to the doctor in years. And maybe they go every couple years and their blood pressure is like 160 and they say, I don't want to take pills. So if somebody's had a blood pressure of 160 for like 20 years, you don't want to all of a sudden make the top number 120. So in that person, you might want to drop them to like 140, wait a couple months, and then try to get them into the 130. So the answer to your question is, too low is different for everybody. If somebody's been 160 or 170 or 180, you don't want to drop them too low because they're going to start to feel bad. In other words, your body starts to get used to the high blood pressure. It doesn't mean it's good. Patients say, well, maybe it's good to have a high blood pressure. It's good to have a decent blood pressure, but you don't want it to be too high because then you're setting yourself up for stroke. So we doctors, we have to balance, right? We want to get you from the 160 range down to like 140, get you out of the stroke range, but not over-treat you. So it's a delicate thing.
So you're still looking like for a baseline or a reference number. So if someone hasn't been in, they haven't had their blood pressure taken in 3 or 4 years, if it's high, you're not going to try and drop it down because you don't know.
Well, you might
how
drop down a little
been.
Bit. Well,
yeah. I mean, it's like they come in and they're 160 over 110. I'm just throwing numbers
right.
at. And you don't know how long they've been at 160. You're not going to try and run them down to 130. You're still going to try and drop them maybe
10 points
150, 140.
Right.
And then after a little period of time, drop them down some more.
So, yeah, if I see somebody who's 160 over 105, I would probably put them on one blood pressure medicine and see him back in a few weeks, you know, because hoping that that one blood pressure medicine probably drops him 10 points, and then see him back in a few weeks, maybe add a second blood pressure medicine. By the way, most people with high blood pressure need 2 or 3 blood pressure medicines. I always love it when I say to a patient, you know, we should add this medicine to lower your blood pressure. And then the first thing they say is, but I'm already on a blood pressure medicine. I go, yeah, your blood pressure is still 160 over 100. Just because you're on a blood pressure medicine doesn't mean you don't need a second. We need to get that top number below 140, and the new guidelines would actually suggest 130 now. And we're doing that to try to save your brain, your heart, your kidneys, and your eyes. But we don't want to over-treat.
You're going to multiple medicines because the one alone didn't work.
Correct. There's very few blood pressure medicines that by themselves is going to drop your blood pressure, you know, from 160 to 120. It just doesn't work that way. Maybe that's a good thing. We don't overcorrect.
Is it possible that one is going to work better than another?
Or yeah, absolutely. There's different.
It sounds like when one doesn't work alone, you're going to add one instead of trying a different one.
So to answer your question, though, Dave, there's different categories of blood pressure medicines.
Okay.
And without getting into all of it in tonight's show, certain patients do better with certain ones. There are certain situations where a beta blocker works better. There's certain situations where an ACE inhibitor works better. There's certain
situations. But that's based on other symptoms other situations that
right.
are going to say.
So if a person.
If A, B, C, and D, then you use this one.
Exactly.
If A, B, D, and E, you use this. Okay.
If somebody has high blood pressure and diabetes, we might do this. If somebody has high blood pressure and they had a heart attack, we might do this. So it depends. But a lot of times, as you said, they need a second blood pressure medicine. A lot of times these blood pressure medicines work well together. And These combinations do work well. There is no perfect blood pressure medicine, and you just have to kind of pick and choose. And I talk to the patients, and I say, you know, there's pros and cons. This type of medicine could cause this. This type of medicine could cause that. The good news, though, is most blood pressure medicines these days are pretty darn well tolerated. I'm old enough to remember when they stunk. I mean, back in the 80s, these blood pressure medicines would last like 6 hours, so you had to take a pill like every few hours, and they made people feel like crap. Now these blood pressure medicines are once a day, most of them, and in the last 5 years, most of them have gone generic. So most blood pressure pills are once a day, and most are generic. 20, 30 years ago, you were taking a pill every 8 hours, and you were paying out the ear. So it's actually, things are, believe it or not, for those of you out there, I'm telling you, I've seen it with my own eyes. Things are better now. The other thing I don't want to forget, though, is 3 things lower blood pressure other than pills. Patients say to me, I'm not a pill person. I say, okay, good. You got to work on low-salt diet, weight loss, regular exercise. Low-salt diet means don't use the salt shaker, but it also, Dave, means don't eat Campbell's soup or other soups. I don't want it. The Campbell Company to get mad at me, but they do make a low sodium soup, so they do. But don't eat the regular soup, don't eat crackers and peanuts and potato chips and ham and turkey. You know, by the way, this is a very bad time of year for congestive heart failure because sauerkraut, Dave, ham, a lot of stuff that we eat around the holidays is loaded with salt.
The local pork and sauerkraut on New Year's Day is not good.
Loaded with salt. You just have to be careful. So if you want to control your blood pressure, you got to do 3 things. stay away from salt and salty foods. Go for a walk. Believe it or not, just like 20 minutes of walking every day lowers your blood pressure. And number three, lose a few pounds. You know, people say, oh, I'm 50 pounds overweight. I can't make a difference. If you lose 5 to 7 pounds, it actually lowers your blood pressure like 5 points. So low salt diet, weight loss, regular exercise, you can literally drop your top number about 10 points just by doing those three things. So the new guidelines really are aimed at lowering the risk of stroke. They're not aimed at making money for the pharmaceutical industry, because I'm going to tell you, the vast majority of blood pressure medicines are generic, and many of them are on the $4 list. So most blood pressure medicines are cheap. You can lower your own blood pressure by the triad of low salt diet, weight loss, regular exercise. It is true we don't want to overcorrect your blood pressure. Somebody out there is saying, you know, I don't believe it. It is true. We don't want to make your blood pressure too low. We want to get you in that sweet spot. Dave and I like to talk baseball. We want to get you in that sweet spot. Get that top number between about 105 and 130. We can get that top number in the 105 or 110 range up to 130. You're going to feel good, and you're hopefully not going to have a stroke. And that's the goal. That's the goal. But remember out there, you don't have symptoms from high blood pressure. See your doctor every 6 months or so. Or at the very least, if you hate doctors, that's fine. At the very least, go to your drugstore and check your own blood pressure. You know, it's crazy not to do it. It's a silent killer. It's frustrating to me because it's preventable, right? I mean, right, Dave? I was taught in medical school, prevent what you can prevent.
This is something, high blood pressure is preventable, it's controllable, and it's something you can do at home yourself. We keep talking about diet. Exercise. Get rid of the salt shaker. If you're concerned that you need more flavor in your foods, there are all kinds of herbs and spices that you can add that will give you flavor.
What's it called? Mrs. Dash or something?
Yep. There are plenty of no salt, salt type additives that you can use. Now, some of them I think have got potassium, and you got to be careful with some other stuff on them.
You know, that's a good point, Dave. That's a great point. When you go to the grocery store, thank you, Dave, where it says salt substitute is potassium. It will say on the bottle, do not take this unless you talk with your doctor. I was thinking of my daughter. I got two daughters in college. They're coming home soon. Salt substitute is potassium. Potassium is safe if you have normal kidney function. If you have abnormal kidney function, it can build up. A little bit's not going to hurt you, but a lot can hurt you. So make sure your doctor says it's okay to take salt substitute.
Or look at the salt substitute. See what's in it. It will tell you what herbs and spices are in it. Make your own. It will cost you maybe 25% of what buying it already prepared. Yeah. Basil, oregano, thyme, parsley, garlic, onion powder. They're all in that. They're just mixing them all up for you together. Make your own.
Oh, you're a smart guy. I didn't know that.
I used to be in the cooking business.
I'm in the eating business.
Okay.
My wife cooks, I eat.
That works.
I do the dishes sometimes.
That's good. It's been a pleasure. We need to wrap it up.
We need to wrap it up, but I just want to say, Carson Wentz, please get better for next year. I'm a diehard Eagles fan. I bleed green. I'm going to cry green. Come on, Eagles. We need a Christmas miracle from Nikki Foles.
Everyone,
go Birds.
Happy holiday.
Be safe.
Happy New Year. Most important to all of our viewers, a healthy New Year. We'll see you again in February.
Go Birds.
Heart to Heart on BCTV is supported by Burke's Cardiologists.